darling in the FranXX. I've been on the internet for a while now, so I've seen what people losing their shit looks like. But darling is different. It's on a bigger scale, and there was much more salt than usual. People argued about bad twists, ships, the ending, and so much more. But it's also different because despite of the shit it got, especially during the twist, which trust me, I will get to, there are still a few people, in fact, I would say a lot of people, who defend it. But why? Why do people defend bad shows? This anime is so bad. The writing, the characters. Nishigori does no shit about fuck Studio Nick saving anime my ass. Literally, watch Neon Genesis Evangelion. Watch fucking Spacebug. I can't understand how some people would like this.
Well, I am one of those people who like it.
So today, I wanna tell you why you should watch Gurren Lagann, because it's better than Darling in almost every way, but also why Darling in the FranXX is a great show, you idiot! Please excuse my hostility, I need to calm down, spoilers. Big part of why I think this anime is great is because of the ending and final messages it delivers. But before we get to that, I want to focus a big chunk of this video on the first 18 episodes and how the show weaves its narrative to deliver those messages in the end.
Now look, I am not a fucking intellectual. I don't care whether my videos are reviews, analysis, or whatever people perceive them as. I'm just a guy talking about things I feel passionate about.
Now, the reason I like Darling in the FranXX is because of its themes. I'm sure you know most of this, but for those few who don't, let's get through this real quick so I can establish some groundwork first. The X and Ys on the uniforms represent chromosomes. X ladies, Y gents. The mechs, FranXX, need a male and a female, XX and XY, to be piloted. The male pilots are called stamens, and females are called pistols, literally flower genitalia. Females are positioned in a doggy pose and have to submit to the male who sits behind them and pilots the FranXX with the handles that are attached to girls' butt. So right away we see that sexuality plays a big part in the world of Darling. But for everything I said to make sense, we need to understand another major theme of the show first, individualism. See, Squad 13 is different from all the other squads. Dr. FranXX wanted to conduct an experiment. What would happen if we allowed a group more freedom? How would they develop as individuals in a more natural environment? Would they uphold more traditional human values? And that's exactly what happened. These children, called parasites, are clones, raised for the only purpose of piloting the FranXX. They're raised in a special observatory called Garden, by the adults who monitor and raise them how they see fit. And they teach them to obey and protect the adults, and that their only purpose is to live to fight. Everyone admires our main protagonist, Hiro. This is confusing to a lot of people because what the hell did he do to deserve that? He just gave them names. Yes. That's exactly what he did. By giving them unique names, what he really gave them is individuality. Hiro was the only member of the group who was always seeking answers. Whereas others just submitted their fates, he was asking questions like, why are they contained in the garden? Why don't they have more freedom? And why are they only identified as numbers? By assigning names to everyone, he basically told them that it's okay to be your own person. It's okay to have your own emotions, ambitions, preferences, personality, a name. This is even further reinforced by how they all have unique FranXX designs, with unique weapons. All the other squads have the same mechs, weapons, and they all fight in unison. Squad 13 is very disorganized in comparison, and at first, they suck because of it. It was a really hard hurdle to overcome at first, because they're all different people with different values. But through the show, by becoming more fleshed out individuals, and by better understanding each other, they can synchronize better and become stronger, because everyone can use their own strengths to their advantage.
Now that we understand that one of the show's main theme is individuality, let's see how it affects the characters when we throw teenage sexuality into the equation.
Because they're all teenagers, it's logical that their puberty will highly affect how they view the opposite sex. And that's the biggest obstacle they have to face when trying to get along. Pay attention to how every exploration of teenage sexuality and individuality applies to every relationship in the show. Let's start with our main protagonist, Hiro. In the first episode, we find that everyone look up to him because he always inspired the group. when they were children. But now that he can't pilot the Franks because he's incompatible with his partner, they sort of pity him. We also get introduced to Zero Two, the partner killer, who is notorious for killing her partners after piloting the Franks with them for just 3 times. They just can't handle a diva like her, you know what I'm saying? When the facility gets attacked by our enemy, the Klaxosaurs, in the last-ditch effort for Hero's life to have any sort of purpose, he gets in the robot with Zero Two, and to nobody's surprise, he can pilot now. Ichigo already starts to get jealous, but is also extremely concerned that if Hiro continues to ride with her, his life might be put in danger, just as Zero Two's previous partners. Because of this desperation, she starts to show affection towards Hiro, but it's too late. Hiro already likes Zero Two. Goro, the best bro of the show, admires Hiro, but he also has feelings for Ichigo, who is now openly showing affection towards Hiro. Mitsuru is unsatisfied with his partner Ikuno, so he says, "What the hell? If this talentless hack Hiro can ride Zero Two, so can I." Nope, he gets fucked. Later, we find out that Ikuno is not attracted to guys, but she likes Ichigo. She tries to ride with her, and it doesn't work. Franks require a male and a female to pilot. Futoshi is actually okay with his kind girl Kokoro. He likes her a lot, so he asks her, "Will we stay together forever?" "Yes," she said. She lied. She didn't like how Futoshi treated her as a queen, but also, Futoshi is Fatoshi, so Kokoro ends up riding with the guy who wasn't too fond of his lesbian partner, Mitsuru. So Futoshi has to be with Ikuno. And the other two? Zorome is a boyish boy, and Miku is a girly girl, and because of their natural differences, they just argue a bunch for a while.
This is only how their relationships start to develop. So now, let's delve a bit deeper into the characters, to see how the situations get temporarily resolved by the end of episode 18.
Zero Two and Hiro debunk the 3-time partner myth, confess their love to each other, and become a cute couple. We'll talk more about them later. Maybe. Ichigo tries her best to get between them, but Hiro tells her, "I love Zero Two." Goro sees that, but to him, this was already obvious long ago. He faced the reality and already came to the realization that if he doesn't use the opportunity, stay true to his feelings, and make a confession, someday he might not live to see another day, and he doesn't want to regret his inaction. So fully knowing that he'll get rejected, he confesses his love to Ichigo way before anyone else. Ikuno, being a lesbian, is frustrated by the limitations of the world.
Two people of the same sex can't reproduce, among many other practical things, and in the world of Darling, they also can't pilot the Franks.
Knowing that, she was always reluctant to express her feelings toward Ichigo. But in frustration, she musters the courage and tells her how she feels anyway. At first sight, it might seem like Trigger is against homosexuality. But listen to how Ichigo comforts her. Because of how she feels towards Hiro, and she has to constantly see him with Zero Two, she can relate to this in her own way. And she tells her that the world is complicated, and sometimes we get the feeling like we don't belong. It sucks sometimes, but we shouldn't feel too bad, because going through all of this and facing reality is what life is all about.
I love this. With media pushing gay representation, I absolutely love how Trigger stays grounded in reality, while also being inclusive and acceptant.
It's not something to be celebrated, because it has real repercussions. But we can empathize and do our best to make different people feel comfort and belonging.
I already mentioned how Zorome and Miku constantly argue because of their biological differences. This situation escalates and reaches the tipping point in episode 8.
In one of their missions, a Klaxosaurus releases a fluid that melts the female parasite suits, completely exposing their hot teen bods.
I'm totally going to prison for this.
Boys get completely engrossed by seeing the naked female form for the first time, oh boy! So, they don't tell them about it. But after the fight, the girls find out and naturally get really mad at the boys for staring at them and not saying anything. This is like a standard situation we see in a lot of shows where it's just used for comedic effect. The girl gets mad, maybe slaps the boy, and that's it. Here, when confronted, Zorome immediately strikes back with, "Why does this upset you so much? It's not like it hurts you or anything." Miku is furious. She can't believe that the boys have been looking at them like that this entire time. How can boys be such creeps? She decides that enough is enough. She doesn't want to be near boys anymore, so they divide the whole facility in half. Girls also take the bath. Boys are obviously against it at first, but soon after decide, you know what? We can do just fine without the girls, so they take the bath in the lake nearby. They even reserve the dining room for themselves and have a feast. Goro even proposes that they drop the silly rules, but girls are too stubborn. The only girl who doesn't mind being near boys and actually thinks parasites being a little bit perverted is good is Zero Two, because that's what best girls do. She sees this as just a dumb game, so she isn't afraid to stir up the pot even more by telling boys that the bath is free for them to use while the girls are in there naked. You can imagine how that goes. Now Miko gets even more enraged at the boys for trying to peep and just being all around awful, which angers Zorome even further, who is baffled by how dramatic and condescending girls can be about such meaningless things. Seems like the opposite sexes just can't get along. But later, when they're in their rooms, they start to think. The girls submit and entrust us with their bodies in the FranXX, and have to do so many other things that we boys never have to think about. Maybe we should be more understanding of their feelings and take better care of them. The girls become aware that there are some things that they can't do without the boys. Yes, they are perverted and weird, but maybe that's in their nature and we shouldn't try so hard to suppress that in them. If we complain all the time, it won't get us anywhere. We're different, but that's exactly why we should work together. Zorome apologizes to Miko and promises to never leer at her again. And this is what she says in response. Arguably, Miko and Zorome had the healthiest relationship after that. They still argued, but that's fine because that's what we do sometimes, as long as in the end we can better understand each other.
And that's another great message from Darling in the FranXX. The reason this speaks to me so much is because I've always seen the feminists, men's rights movements, or whatever, in this day and age as unnecessary, at least in the more civilized societies. All the marches, protests, and all the other parades we throw aren't going to get us anywhere. People should take it upon themselves to better understand each other. And if someone can't, we should do our best to let them know how we feel and convince them individually. And that's also what this show is telling us.
Episode 7, it's a beach episode. Hiro and Zero Two are having their cute lovey-dovey time while others are checking out the girls.
They look so soft and squishy, don't they?
But midway, they go on a little adventure and find remnants of a small city before people moved into the plantations. Here, Kokoro finds a booklet about childbirth. Whoa, nice save, Chatsuru. This is where she starts to get engrossed by the idea of having a baby, and she starts asking questions. She's been meeting up with Mitsuru in her little garden and talking to him for a while now. She thinks it's cool how forward and blunt he is, compared to Futoshi, who is kissing her ass all the time. It's never directly said, but that, alongside him being fat and complacent with it, she abandons him to ride with Mitsuru. In the events that follow, she starts making her move on Mitsuru, and in episode 16, they kiss. No wait, their relationship progresses to them having sex in episode 17. That's right, Kokoro becomes pregnant in episode 17, and in episode 18, they get married. Talk about moving quick. We'll talk about those two a little bit more later. But for now, let's look at how Futoshi is doing. I noticed a lot of people saying how unfairly Futoshi was treated, and how Kokoro is the literal worst.
Look, if you want to think that, it's fine. If you want to live your fantasies, project yourself onto a fat guy, participate in shipping wars, and wish to see him get the cute, kind girl, I'll let you be. But that's kinda unrealistic. I mean, fat guy wants a hot chick, never tries losing weight, and just does nothing to deserve her. Treats the girl as a queen, and is constantly nice to her, telling her how cute she is, only for the girl to then choose an asshole who is better looking and more confident. Come on, guys, don't tell me you can't relate to this in some way.
And you know what? Kokoro didn't do that to spite Futoshi. She's even apologetic about it. The reality is, things just don't go our way all the time. And you know what? That's the best possible thing that could have happened to Futoshi. He understands why that happened and starts wishing the best for them. He puts himself in hard situations just so he can get over it and even starts losing weight. Guys, this show is not about cuckoldry, but about exploring different teenage relationships. Sometimes it works out and it's great, but even then you have to face adversity. And sometimes it doesn't and it sucks, but you move on and become stronger because of it. And that's how characters and relationships develop in the first 18 episodes. Darling in the Franxx gets criticized a lot for lack of character development, and compared to something like Gurren Lagann or Evangelion, two shows people like to compare Franxx a lot to, yes, I do agree, they're not nearly as good. But actions define a character, and through all the interactions that happen, I feel like I understand what kind of people those kids are, which in my eyes makes them decent characters.
I notice a lot of people say that the first two-thirds of the show have a lot of what feels like filler. But when you consider that those two themes play an essential role, it's clear how every interaction Squad 13 has is to complement those themes.
Now, before I move into the more controversial episode 19 and 20, I want to draw attention to what is perhaps my favorite episode of the show. No, not that one, that's like second or third. I'm talking about episode 16. The leaders, kings, gods of the world of Darling is the organization called Ape, specifically Papa. They are the one who ordered supplying the Squad 13 with food, water, fresh clothes, electricity, and just to be taken care of. But the Dr. FranXX is the one responsible for taking care of them. Up until now, while Dr. FranXX allowed more personal freedom to the 13s, he still obeyed the orders of Papa and took care of them. But now he wants to take his personal experiment further. So in episode 16, he disobeys the order and leaves the teenagers to their own devices. When the episode starts, it's already been a month since they had any contact with the adults, and it seems like Papa has abandoned them. Zorome is looking through binoculars to check when Papa is coming back. He was always the most openly reliant on them. In the beach episode I discussed earlier, he says, Before each meal, they would pray to Papa, thank him for food, care, and generosity. Just like how religious people pray and have faith in God, the parasites have faith in Papa, and despite taking care of themselves for a month, they still pray to him. They start questioning, why did Papa abandon them? Life is so much harder now that they have limited resources, like electricity, water, and food, and they have to do all the chores themselves. It sucks! But by trying to survive and relying on each other, they start to catch fish, harvest the plants, and make their own food. And you know what? They become closer and have more fun than they ever did. And just before they're about to dig into their own meal that they worked hard for, Zorome interrupts the prayer and says, why should we have to pray when we did everything ourselves? The gods have abandoned them, and they took their own fates into their own hands. We can even look at it from a more literal perspective. Papa, or father, the adults, their parents, are not there anymore. And this is their first step of growing up and providing for themselves. Man, you know I'm a sucker for this kind of stuff. Up until now, they've been told that they live to fight, but in episode 16, 17, and 18, for the first time, they truly become individuals and learn that they don't need to live to serve some kind of higher purpose, but that they live for themselves and that they need to fight to live. They are still bummed out about it, but as they reminisce on everything they had to go through, they realize that it's not so bad after all.
Oh boy.
Two,
So episode 1 to 18 are great. I like the themes, the characters, action, and I'm just all around enjoying the show. But I'm waiting for some answers.
I know it's a trigger show, and they'll just escalate the story to a whole new level in the last 6 episodes. I wanna know why the Klaxosaurs are attacking humans. I wanna know what's up with the magma energy they've been referencing. More importantly, why did people lose their individuality? And why is the show pushing sexuality to such an extent? What went wrong? We get most of the answers in episode 19. Now, let's just make one thing clear before I start talking about it as if I'm defending it. This is a horrible episode. Not only because I expected the answers to be more grounded in reality, so the mentioned themes and messages can make sense when applied to the real world, but also because it's just an exposition dump presented in a really boring way.
In retrospect, I don't really hate this episode, but Darling the Franks deserved better. Now, allow me to make the best defense for it I can.
Okay, so considering it's just a boring exposition episode, I feel like if I try to describe what happened, this part of the video will also be equally boring exposition shit, and I need to lay some groundwork for the analysis. So, let's do something more interesting instead. I was tagged by Core Reviews to do this anime cipher thing anyway, and I don't wanna do it 3 months later. I'm not going to fire shots, trust me, I want to. But not here. I'm just going to drop some bars, so here we go, episode 19 recap. This episode is from the view of Dr. Werner FranXX, a genius scientist who got to climb the ranks. Long ago, an organization called APOS formed. Origin, ethnicity, and everything unknown, they discovered how to harness magma energy. It's a new hot thing, it spreads throughout the world entirely. That's how APO politically gained power. A new partner, someone who we know is much more smarter. APO tell Dr. FranXX that dying is gay. Make us all immortal, and he says, okay. He wants to make us more than just some dumb homo sapiens. His morals are awful, his excuse, he's an atheist? With the magma energy, he reaches immortality. But we can make babies, so I question the humanity. Everyone's immortal, and APO become kings. But because of the new energy, the surface kinda stinks. Oops, magma's not too green, the earth becomes a desert. Klax want their magma back, we fight and humans get hurt. Our weapons can do shit, the Klaxosaurus just won't crack, so we steal their tech and make the robots known as FranXX. Oops, turn out the pilot, those things we need working code, so let's just do the test with the few that can reproduce. Warner's wife was only there, so he has something to lose. Rip, she dies, no one cares, at least now he can't get a clue. Man and woman work together to get rid of pain. Not enough breathers, so that is kinda lame. Again, mad scientist disobeys his civil rights. He makes clones as pilots and calls them parasites. But then he also meets the Klaxosaurus queen, and he steals the hair of the hot dino teen. He used her DNA to make a new species who is the new human dino hybrid 02. Let's talk about Dr. Werner FranXX first. Everyone agrees that he's a horrible person because of all the immoral things that he has done with cloning. But a lot of people, me included, hate the fact that they use atheism as justification for lack of morality. Some argue that Dr. FranXX contradicts the messages established before this episode. That, I disagree with. While Dr. FranXX doesn't believe in God, he is quite fond of playing God himself, and because of all disregard for the consequences, because of his curiosity, lustful pursuit of knowledge and producing results, because he wants to see our final phase of evolution so badly, he stares into the abyss, and the abyss stares back at him, making him lose his humanity. The episode is even titled Inhumanity. Individuality, carving your future with your own hands, and being personally responsible is a big message of Darling. And at the start of the episode, he looks at APO and all the horrible things they're doing to children and asks himself, how is he any different? And I think that Dr. FranXX is aware of everything he's done, and that's why he wants to redeem himself, by giving Squad 13 a way to live the way humans used to, and to love like he once did. Still, Dr. FranXX is a deeply flawed character, and I really wish they did a better job with him. Now, what are the answers to the questions? Why did humans abandon individuality? Because humans became immortal, and they even invented machines that inject happiness in them directly, there was no personal adversity anymore. I think it's death that gives our short lives meaning. With our limited time, we feel the need to achieve something, or at the very least, survive. That's how we develop values which give us meaning. Without values, and thus meaning, they all become equal. Meaningless. This was in big part because of APO. Why did humans abandon sexuality? When you're immortal, you don't need to think about the future. No need to reproduce if the future is already secure with them living forever. This was in big part because of Ape. But who is Ape really? Well, we get the answer to that question in episode 20. Out of nowhere, without foreshadowing, it turns out that they are aliens, a collective life form who wants to assimilate humans to become like them, formless, without physical bodies weighing us down, Verm. I hate them. Science fiction can be a speculative exercise, so we can see what would happen if in a hypothetical scenario something happened to us to change the future drastically. It's the question I was most excited to finally get answered. It's because of aliens. Now, plot-wise, they do make justifications for it later. And still, in the end, it was humans who chose to abandon humanity. Chances are that if they refused, Verm would use more forceful methods anyway. But we can't ignore that it was humanity's choice. But to me, it still feels a little bit out of humanity's control. What if Verm just literally represents an alien life form who would impose their values on humanity? I can take that, but again, it makes the sci-fi part of the show weaker. Okay, so what if Verm just represents the extreme collectivist, sort of authoritarian left philosophy? That's a bit better, but it's so ridiculously extreme. I never met anyone, communist, socialist, gender equal, feminist, homosexual, or whatever kind of person, who is even remotely close to Verm's ideology. When we talk about equality, no one really wants what Verm wants. I can take it as a speculative exercise, it's just a bit too meaningless for my taste, but I'll go with that since it makes the most sense for now.
This show had so much potential, and I just feel like it jumped the shark with these two episodes. Darling deserved better.
Like, remember how in Gurren Lagann, they were already alluding to something bigger in like episode 13 to 15? That's called foreshadowing. Then alien lifeforms attack them at the end of episode 16 for overpopulating Earth, only to fully reveal themselves as anti-spirals in like episode 20 or something, where they fully explain that too many races with spiral powers, such as humans, would create spiral nemesis, destroying the whole universe, and they're only limiting them because they want to prevent that disaster. Remember how the show's message was, overpopulation and abuse of powers lead to destruction, so let's make them abandon their individuality and oppress them with fear and violence, but then Simone showing them that that's not the right way because people have something called personal responsibility? That's where Darling fails compared to its peers. But Darling is not like its peers. It's trying to say something a bit different.
But before I go and defend the show again, let's make this clear. By far, the biggest problem with this anime is that the plot is not perfect. It has holes, it's missing some explanations, and sometimes it doesn't support its themes perfectly.
But I like the themes. I feel like it'd be wrong of me to just focus and criticize the show for going from A to C instead of A to B to C without considering any thematic implications of the plot structure. And you know what? The themes? They're still there and persist through. That's when I realized something. Notice how everyone is reacting to this revelation. They are shocked, just like we were. They can't believe what is happening. Their world is turning upside down. Everything they believed in is a lie. Papa? Look how they don't know how to do anything without Papa. They can't even maintain themselves. And why do you think Verm didn't die at the end? It's because they represent complacency. It represents a threat to humanity in the scenario where we abandon said humanity and become complacent. It doesn't have a form, it's not even a villain. It's just a vehicle so Nishigori can tell us about his values, his messages, and present them through themes. In the end, it never was about Verm, or mechs, or space battles. And yes, you can't point to a show that does each theme better individually. But I challenge you to find something that covers so much. Gurren Lagann? Sure, that's a show that's like twice as good, but there is one thing that Darling says that its peers don't, and that is...
procreation, baby!
Ever since Kokoro discovered that booklet about childbirth, she naturally, out of her own instincts, starts asking, why don't humans have babies anymore when giving birth to new life is such a wonderful thing? She falls in love with Mitsuru and convinces him to have children. But to Papa, who we now know is Verm, the idea of breeding new life to create even more creatures with physical bodies who will grow into unique individuals seems useless. But when humans broke out of their shackles and start fighting against Verm, they see that reproducing is how they will continue to exist, and that's what gives them hope. Meaning is something we all have to find for ourselves. Goro wasn't going to let Hiro outshine him, so he travels the world to scout for resources like a badass. Ichigo had to let Hiro go, and with time, Goro became more desirable, so they end up together. Pity sex? No, boys. This is how life is. You don't think about one person you met when you were a child forever. You move on and fall in love with someone else. And Goro completely deserved it, and that's why he became a father. Futoshi used his Fatoshi love for food and started baking. And look, he even made three rascals himself. Zoroma and Miko don't have kids and instead become teachers for the new generations. Though I think that's because of the effect of accelerated aging disease. That was easily the worst and most unexplained aspect of the show. Which Ikono basically cured! She stayed true to herself, hooked up with Naomi and had a loving relationship, and found her purpose in science and cured the disease, saving hundreds. What a champ! But what set all of this in motion is one of the ways we as a species found meaning since our existence. It's finding a suitable partner, loving each other, and then creating the biggest legacy a human can, a child.
I've seen people question, what do the early themes of the show lead up to after the reveal of aliens? Plot-wise, it just doesn't seem like it has any connection. And I see that as kind of an immature way of looking at the themes.
Sexuality, individualism, self-actualization, it all leads to this one moment. One of the most beautiful and life-affirming scenes I've seen in recent memory watching anime. Kokoro, saving humanity, giving her life meaning and finding true purpose by giving birth to Ai. It's the one thing they weren't taught, and it's the one thing that in the end saved humanity.
I know. I realize that a lot of nerds, and especially anime fans, don't really vibe with messages like that. And some say that this is all just propaganda so they can make Japs make babies.
But what I see is Nishigori and other creators expressing themselves, their beliefs, their values, and that's what art is and what makes it great. And what they have to say speaks to me a lot personally. Sure, in the end it might serve the purpose of what, hey Japs, please fuck more, we will go extinct, propaganda might have. But this is also an issue in Europe and elsewhere. But above everything else, the show is trying to present to us why we should maybe embrace some of the more traditional human values, which appeals to my life philosophy. People compare Darling in the Franxx to prior Trigger and Gainax shows, and maybe some of them are justifiable, but it saddens me, because they compare them on such a superficial level that it makes me think that not only did they not understand what Darling had to say, but also what the other great shows such as Gurren Lagann, Eva, Gunbuster were all about. They expected a show with cool action and mech battles to escape reality, but instead got a wholesome story about love and procreation, bringing them back to reality. But you know, if you pay attention, there is one thing that all of these shows have in common. Be someone's wings, huh? You didn't think I would forget to talk about her, did ya? How could I forget to talk about the best girl and one of the most beautifully poetic romantic tales I've ever seen? Jian, a bird that possesses only one wing. Unless a male and a female partner lean on each other and act as one, they can't take flight. It hides in the leaves and dreams of the day it can fly through the sky. They're imperfect and pitiful creatures. Aren't we in some regards very similar? But I think it's that struggle that makes us truly appreciate the great things in life, such as our partner, our wings. Hiro is someone who desperately wants to be someone's wings, because he very much lives to fight. But 02 is someone who desperately needs wings, someone who can stay with her for more than just 3 times so she can kill enough Klaxosaurs and become human. In the first episode, Hiro and 02 meet, and because they complement each other's goals, they become partners. Even though Hiro is aware that he might die, if he doesn't pilot, life is meaningless. He lives to fight. 02 feels some kind of bond with him, but is still unsure and she needs someone anyway, so what the hell, right? Now, because 02 is half Klaxosaurus, and because so many pilots died because of her, people, including 13s, treat her as a monster. Naturally, they also want to protect Hiro from her, but he understands 02 a little better and tells everyone that she's human. A normal girl. Before riding together, for the third time, 02 asks Hiro, "Why do you fight?" To which he replies, "So I can protect the adults." "That's boring," says 02. But after Hiro somehow survives 3 times and turns out to be reliable, his purpose changes a bit. Now, he wants to fight for 02, get to know her better, and be her wings. For a little bit, everything goes well, but 02 starts becoming impatient. She has a reliable partner, but why is she not getting closer to what she wants? Why is she still not human? Now combine that with the constant provocations, and she kinda starts to lose her mind. Hiro still constantly tells her that he likes her just the way she is, and even confesses his feelings and tells her that he loves her, but she doesn't really care. She thinks he likes her just for her looks anyway. In the next battle, 02 is kinda going berserk and puts other teammates in danger. And Hiro tries to calm her down, telling her that that's not how she will become human. In fact, right now, she's acting like a monster. She sees this as him just trying to tie her down, and she tries to choke him. What is he to her anyway? She's just using him like she did all the other parasites. And that's when their minds connect and they see each other's past. Enter the cutest episode I've ever seen. It starts from 02's oldest memory of how she received a picture book, The Beast and the Prince. She couldn't understand the words, but the beautifully colored pictures were enough for her to understand that she was like the beast in the story. The picture book depicts a tale of a beast princess with ashen wings who falls in love with a human prince. Then a witch grants her wish of becoming human in exchange for her wings. The prince falls in love with her and they get married and enjoy life for a while, only for her to someday turn into a monster and grow her black wings and fly away in the middle of the night, leaving the prince alone. We know how curious and nosy Hiro was, so when he sees how badly they are treating 02, he takes the opportunity and tries to escape with her. They go on a wholesome adventure, where this scene happens. But what is really happening here is something that's much more important to 02. Hiro shows her the world and how beautiful it can be, explains the picture book to her, and he gives her a name. 02, for the first time, sees how wonderful the world is, and that her life once again follows the events of the picture book. For her, Hiro is now the prince, and her goal is to become human so she can be with her darling. Unfortunately, their journey is short-lived, and they are caught and taken back to the garden. Adults erase their memories, and Hiro forgets most of the things that made everyone look up to him. But for 02, this experience is something that can't be erased because it's so meaningful. Cut back to them in Strelizia, and 02 is in tears as she realizes what just happened. She was trying so hard to become human, while her darling was with her all along, telling her that she's fine the way she is. And just think about this for a moment. Hiro was the one who showed 02 the world, but after the adults deleted his memory, it was 02 who came back and taught him what he taught her on that day. Bro, this is so fucking poetic. I'm not crying, you're crying. Look at how happy they are together after this. I can't handle it. Now that 02 fully recalls the picture book, she draws the whole story back herself, except for the final page. It's a sad ending, and she doesn't want the same to happen to them. Later, after the reveal of aliens, they push them back with Strelizia Apath. But something's wrong. 02 becomes a potato. Turns out that she left her body, and her soul is in Strelizia, fighting in space. Hero rushes to space to reunite with her and finally truly becomes her wings, symbolized by Apath transforming into Strelizia Apis, who resembles a braid, symbolizing marriage. Absolutely beautiful. Look, the bomb is her flowers, the passage is the carpet, and the gate is the podium. And after they cross it, they go on their honeymoon. Two years pass until they reach the alien planet. In the meantime on Earth, people are already rebuilding, and I is already over a year old. Unfortunately, they have to sacrifice themselves to detonate the bomb. After going through all of this and spending over 2 years in space together, after 02 finding what makes us human and Hero learning that he doesn't want to live to fight, but instead fight to live, after they detonate, their bond is now so strong that their souls fly together through space and come back to Earth, reincarnating and meeting under the cherry blossom tree where 02's physical body decomposed, while Hero is reading the Beast and the Prince picture book. This is so poetic! They become each other's wings and tie the Jian story with the picture book by changing fate, so instead of the Beast flying away alone, they become one and fly together. This is so poetic! I know that the general consensus is that the ending of Darling in the Franxx is bittersweet, but I can't taste anything bitter in this. It's just pure sugar. This story, combined with everything I said in this video, is what makes this anime, in only words that come to mind to describe it, life-affirming. Because it shows what makes us, humans, beautiful. Is Darling in the Franxx man mode? Yes, it is.
Like I said, I really like what it has to say. And make no mistake, I am aware that it doesn't deliver on it fully. But think about this. It's a very ambitious show. Most shows, even some I like more than Darling, don't even try to say as much. And even though it wasn't delivered perfectly, are we to blame it for trying? And the thing is, I also think the show is just enjoyable in the surface level. The characters, events, animation, great soundtrack, Trigger and A1 made something memorable. It's touched on everything on my spectrum of my emotions, yes, even disappointment. And just comparing it to other shows, I like Megalobox, but I won't remember fucking Megalobox in a few months. But I will remember scenes like this. And this! And the giant 02 in space is just iconic! So let's cut the show a little slack. And for those of you who just didn't know any better, it's time for you to apologize. Say I apologize!
Here comes the shilling part. Patreon, please give me money. I'm broke. Thanks. Follow me on Twitter. I post funny things sometimes. I post cute girls sometimes. If you don't like things like that, don't follow me. I don't care. I just like higher numbers because they boost my ego. I'm really bad at this. Bye!